how the New World Order has this fascination with pyramids and the all-seeing eye. Isn't it strange how it all leads back to Egypt? I mean, look at Aleister Crowley here all dressed up like an Egyptian. Do you old-timers remember the Alan Parsons Project? They came out with an album called Lucifer, and they had this song called The Eye in the Sky.
I am the eye in the sky.
It's all starting to make sense now, isn't it? Now, I got a lot of flack for my last video. Someone actually accused me of dwelling on dark things. No, I'm exposing evil. And the Bible exposes evil, too. Now, I'm going to talk about this eye in the sky. Why is it in the sky? I'm going to read from the King James Version, even. Wherein in times past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. That's Ephesians 2:2. So obviously it's Satan that is the power of the air according to the Bible. He's piped over the radio, then it was the television, and now it's the internet. Now back to their fascination with Egypt. Look at David Bowie, this Luciferian dressed up like an Egyptian. And here we have Satan's leading ladies, Beyoncé and Rihanna, dressed like Nefertiti. She is the wife of Akhenaten, also known as Amenhotep, that had the unusual DNA that did not appear to be human to the scientists. Well, as it turns out, Nefertiti might not have necessarily been human either. But they couldn't study her DNA because her body was never found. Now, I found this interesting clip on Ancient Aliens about Nefertiti.
That Queen Nefertiti was not of this world.
Nefertiti's parents are unknown. On pictures, she's shown with one of these elongated heads. Now we know the gods, the old Egyptian gods, they had longer heads than we have. And according to the pyramid texts, sometimes they left the earth and then they returned again. So Nefertiti's parents were maybe extraterrestrials.
King Akhenaten and his wife looked completely different than all the other ancient Egyptian kings. King Akhenaten always was depicted with an elongated skull, a bigger size hip, a belly that drools over his belt. He believed that he wasn't a man, and he wasn't a woman, and he wasn't a king, he was just something else.
The most unusual feature is elongated skulls. There's been a lot of discussions about what these skulls meant, whether they were literally elongated skulls or whether they were just decoration features. It's certainly very intriguing. It doesn't appear before or afterwards. So there's something rather odd about this, I have to admit.
The reign of Akhenaten and Nefertiti introduced a new and controversial monotheistic faith to Egypt, worshipping the disc-shaped sun god, Aten.
The Aten was described as this flying sun disc. Egyptologists are merely saying that this was nothing else but the sun. But the question is, can the sun instruct you in different disciplines? And the answer is no. So we have to see whether or not our ancestors encountered technology and misinterpreted it as something in nature.
Now, as a Christian, I don't fall for the Ancient Alien TV series claiming that the aliens created us. I don't fall for that. But I do think they're onto something as far as maybe these were extraterrestrials of some sort. And when I say extraterrestrials, I mean other beings, spirit beings. I mean, if you believe in the Bible, you have to believe that angels exist. And those are beings that are not human. And there are different types of angels. So there are other things that exist other than humans. I mean, look at the animal kingdom. So, I do not believe it's too far out. I think they're right on with this. I just think they go off course when they try to say that these aliens created us. I do not believe that. Okay, let's get back to the Egypt connection. Did you know that there are several nefarious organizations that base their teachings on Egyptology? Of course, Rosicrucianism is at the top of the list. They claim to be 5,000 years old. They claim that their most famous members were Akhenaten and Nefertiti. There's no surprise there. Some of their well-known members are Walt Disney, Leonardo da Vinci, and Napoleon Bonaparte. They helped to inspire the Freemason activities in Scotland in the 1700s, as well as many satanic, witchcraft, and demonology cults of the Victorian age. They also influenced some of our founding fathers in America, such as William Penn, Benjamin Franklin, and George Washington. The next one is Thelema. This is an invention of Aleister Crowley. He claimed that he heard from an Egyptian god during his honeymoon in Cairo. He spent the night with his new wife in a pyramid, so I want to share a short clip of this.
Took his wife into the king's chamber for the night to, in effect, show off his magical abilities. What happened that night, we only have Crowley's own words, and they can't be corroborated. But I will read his own account from his own autobiography. Crowley says, "I wanted my wife to see what a great magician I was. We went accordingly after dinner with candles. More from habit than anything else, as I imagine, I had with me a small notebook of Japanese vellum, in which were written my principal invocations, etc. Among these was a copy of the preliminary invocation of the Goetia. We reached the king's chamber after dismissing the servants at the foot of the grand gallery. By the light of a single candle placed on the edge of the coffer, I began to read the invocation. But as I went on, I noticed that I was no longer stooping to hold the page near the light. I was standing erect, but the manuscript was not less but more legible. Looking about me, I saw that the king's chamber was glowing with a soft light, which I immediately recognized as the astral light. I have been accustomed to describe the colour as ultraviolet from its resemblance to those rays in the spectrum, which I happen to be able to distinguish. The range varies, but it is quite noticeably beyond that visible to the normal human eye. The colour is not unlike that of an arc lamp. It is definitely less coloured than the light of a mercury lamp. If I had to affix a conventional label, I should probably say pale lilac, but the quality of the light is much more striking than the colour. Here the word phosphorescence occurs to the mind. It is one of the mysteries of physics that the total light of the sky is very much greater than can be accounted for by the luminous bodies in the heavens. There are various theories, but I personally believe that the force now called radioactivity, which we know to be possessed in some degree by every particle of matter, is responsible. Our eyes are affected with the impression of light by forces, which are not in themselves recognized as luminous. However, back to the facts. The king's chamber was aglow, as if with the brightest tropical moonlight. The pitiful, dirty yellow flame of the candle was like a blasphemy, and I put it out. The astral light remained during the whole of the invocation, and for some time afterwards, though it lessened in intensity as we composed ourselves to sleep.
Now we have the most famous Egyptian-inspired secret society of the world, Freemasonry, which was heavily influenced by Rosicrucianism. The Masons connect themselves with a Greek explorer named Thrice, who traveled around ancient Egypt. He promoted a god named Thoth. He combined Thoth with Amenhotep, the pharaoh. Thrice would conjure up spirits from statues of Amenhotep and Thoth for wisdom, science, and medicine. He wrote extensively on these ideas, which began to circulate among the other stone builders in Italy and Greece. Then they were given to the Europeans. They began to make Amenhotep the center of a new ancient secret society Grand Master, the first of the Freemasons. You notice how we have the same pharaoh over and over again? And now we get to these people, and they are so hated that you cannot even say the name of their group. This new German religion thought that they were originally from Atlantis, which was once a perfect utopia until it was destroyed. They believed that they were a special race called Aryans. In the 1920s, the Germans were looking for their origins beyond Christianity. Many of the ancient Egyptian texts were just beginning to be translated and spoke to a group of people that came by boat from the north, from the land of ice where the sun never sets. Germans took this to mean Denmark, Sweden, and Norway. As they formed a new Germanic origin story with Odin as their new god over Christianity, inevitably the words of the ancient Greek legends would help form their idea of the master race from which they were born. Then their leader, whose name I can't even say, would elaborate that the Germans are descendants from the Aryans that founded ancient Egypt, Greece, and India. But that the further south the Aryans traveled, the more they intermixed racially with the indigenous population, thus losing their godly qualities of blonde hair, blue-eyed, and 7 feet tall beauty. Their secret is out. This shows that they're following the same ringleader, and he's an entity that opposes the God of the Bible. He's called by various names, but we know him as Satan or Lucifer. They have various secret or ancient names for him, one of them being Osiris. They think that they're going to resurrect him someday. But their hope is in vain. The true God has already resurrected, and his name is Jesus Christ.